a Mark Webb, ci sono molti colleghi della carta stampata, quale vorrebbe scegliere come titolo dei giornali domani, dei giornali italiani per questo nuovo Spider-Man?
I think Spider-Man is the he's an uncynical superhero who is going to have to confront the face of evil for the first time, and he will be transformed because of it.
You speak Italian? No, he doesn't speak Italian.
Ho studiato la francese tanti anni fa.
Amazing. Oh. The amazing Mark Webb.
No, that's all.
So a kind of a surprising new.
Yeah, it's surprising. I think something from the comic books that I enjoyed, you know, the Gwen Stacy saga was a really provocative storyline that changed not only the Spider-Man universe, but all of comics back in the 70s. And it was a really fantastic ride, a difficult journey really for all of us to go on, and it's something that I think people will be talking about for a while, and I think it was really fun for all of us to explore. I think we really enjoyed that. He's different than a lot of other superheroes because he's a kid, and he is not a billionaire. He's not a alien. He's a kid who has to pay rent and has trouble with his girlfriend and all these domestic relationships. And I think he's the most relatable superhero behind the mask of anybody.
Yeah, I agree, you know. I can't really add much to that apart from, you know, the suit, as we've said many times at this point, you don't see any skin color, you don't see where Spider-Man is from, so anyone around the world, and this is what we've felt all around the world, is that everyone can project themselves into the suit. You don't see that it's a white, skinny Queens boy in the suit. You can imagine it's anybody, black, white, Chinese, Italian. And I think that's incredibly potent and powerful for them. That's why this character is loved as well.
And what's great about Andrew and Emma when they're acting, they're really good improvisatory actors. So they are very awake and in the moment and alive, and they build on the nuances of each other's performance. So as an audience member, it feels very real. It doesn't feel scripted. And that improvisation, I think, adds a really special layer to a movie that is shrouded in spectacle and massive effects and action. You need that humanity.
Well, I would just say that that was something that I think Mark was very clear about from the very beginning, that he cared deeply about this relationship and protecting this relationship and giving Andrew and I the space to explore and to improvise and to kind of find the different layers to Gwen and Peter. And the writers were very protective of that as well. So that was a huge part of why I wanted to be a part of this movie, was that Gwen and Peter's relationship was just really beautiful and really fleshed out and meant a lot to me, and the hope of it and the tragedy of it is, I think, incredibly meaningful as Peter Parker moves forward into becoming stronger and stronger as Spider-Man.
The pre-loser, I think it was, all very exciting and challenging, and I think any actor would tell you that when you get a chance to play, you know, two roles. I mean, Dane, I'm sure you can chime in on this, is the fact that you start out as this sort of, you know, corny, goofball guy with the comb over and everything like that, and then you get a chance to display, you know, your talents as a villain. It was cool. There were times when in playing Max, you know, we got, you know, laugh out loud moments. And then there was times in playing Electro, we had some really villainous and really, you know, exciting moments. So both characters, the pre-loser and then the blue loser, were fantastic.
Yes, my daughter is happy about the whole situation. And what's great about her, she's only 5 years old, but even at the age of 3.5, 4, she was on the set of Django, and that'll be on the set of Spider-Man, who she just, you know, went crazy about. When I told her that I was gonna be in Spider-Man, she frowned, like, who are you gonna play in Spider-Man? When she found out I was playing the
Village, yeah, well, the Village gonna kick your butt. We all had a laugh, but they were great. Mark was great in letting my daughter hang out on the set and dress as Spider-Man while I was dressed as Electro. So, and that just speaks to the franchise. I mean, to be honest, going around the world with these guys, it's been mind-blowing to be in Beijing, Tokyo, Singapore, Malaysia, and see, you know, hundreds of kids dressed up as Spider-Man from age 2 to 5. So it's amazing that the franchise has that type of reach where you can hit kids, and at the same time you got my homies that are grown like, yo, I'm going to check that Spider-Man with my kids. So it's just an amazing franchise to be a part of.
Yeah, there's a lot of specific artists. I mean, I think the suit, we kind of went back to a more traditional version of the suit, which there was, you know, with the belt and the webbing, what was from the Ditko version. But we looked a lot at Brian Bendis was a writer in the Ultimates, and there was an attitude there which we really liked. But Mark Bagley was the artist that we liked. And McFarlane started to reinvented Spider-Man many years ago. And there was an expressive quality, a really exaggerated, almost illustrated quality to his That you get in that comic, in those comics, and those were things that I know Andrew's familiar with, and we talked about from the very beginning. There was something, you know, in terms of the movement. There's a lot of references that he can bring up, but I'll hand it off to him in a second. But there are a few things. So much about this at the beginning of the process was about joy and about Spider-Man having a blast being Spider-Man and embracing that sort of almost like cartoon-like bombastic quality to all the characterizations. And there was a specific kind of thing. There was a moment where you let go of one web and you're floating in the air before you shoot another web. There was just space. We call it it's being in the flying in the negative space where it's not connected to anything, and it's as close to flight, actual flight, as Spider-Man gets. And I wanted to embrace that moment because it feels totally liberating and totally free. And honestly, that's kind of how we felt at the beginning of this process. And then in terms of specific things that, you know, I think Andrew has some good things that he's paid attention to in terms of the physicality.
The great thing about the character is that, you, as Mark said, cartoon is a great word and a great thing to go to because he has to feel beyond human. That's incredibly exciting to be able to attempt. So, first of all, when you think about the humans that seem superhuman in what they do, and there are, you know, countless examples of that, like Muhammad Ali, Ronaldo, all the great Usain Bolt, the great sportsmen of our time and of history, and you kind of pick and choose little bits from that. Pharrell Williams, weirdly, was an inspiration for me in terms of his energy and his vibrancy and his rebelliousness, and he seems to embody what it is to be youth, like to be young and to need to break the walls down. So I wanted to kind of encapsulate that in the physicality of Spider-Man. And then Bugs Bunny is someone we always came back to just because he is doing such extreme things. And that's really, really exciting to attempt in a physical human body. So yeah, it was really, really fun to... And of course, the countless, you know, poses from comics that you can always go back to. It's a really amazingly lucky job to be reading comics for a living. It's very cool.
Harry Osborn and the Green Goblin are characters that have been around for almost 50 years now. And I think there's parts of them that, you know, you have to familiarize yourself with the source material. And you have to understand who has Harry Osborn always been, who has the Green Goblin always been, and have an understanding of that. And make sure you honor those characters in this new franchise. But also what's exciting is you get the chance to bring it into the modern day and to give the world a new Harry Osborn and a new Green Goblin, and where do they exist within this world within today? And that's what's really exciting. And that was the challenge. Luckily we had a great script, and I was able to kind of find the through line of how does Harry go from one extreme to the next, and have it all still make sense. And obviously Mark was a big help in that process as well.
I just let them do their thing.
What?
I just let them do their thing. I didn't have to do anything. It was great.
Don't lie, you coached us both so intensely.
You coached us every day.
The ways of love.
Yeah.
Do Okay. Well, I forgot. I just was watching in the background, having a good time, smiling and getting a little weepy and misty every once in a while. I don't know. Like there was. I think it's just about protecting the process and trying to create an environment in which that feels as real as possible. And then we would play music. We would talk. We would. I'm trying to think of any specific direction. I don't remember anything, honestly. It was just about trying to create an environment that was reflective of the scene that we were trying to create and trying to protect that.
It's a real testament to Mark as a director, because I think it's such a delicate thing to attempt to capture the most intimate of human moments that we experience in our lives, and to allow all of us in these intimate scenes, you know, maybe not love scenes, but there is love between all these characters in different ways. To forget there's a camera rolling, to forget there are crew members around, to forget that we're making a movie, to actually truly believe in that this is happening right now. And it's Mark is an amazing at creating that very sacred, magical space. Oh man, it's too much work to be done to decide on one thing. What's the most pressing thing right now? God, there's so much going on. Global warming's a good one. And you know that there are no sides in that. You're either on the side of the earth or you're not. So that's a pretty clean thing to fight for. And actually, you know what? We partnered up with an amazing organization called Earth Hour that had its launch in Singapore, and it was a very, very beautiful moment. And so yeah, Spider-Man is a good and school bullying. I think if I was actually Spider-Man, I would put an end to school bullying and cyberbullying. Somehow, I would figure out a way, or I'd dedicate my life to it.
I probably wouldn't want to do much good for the world, but if I was a good goblin, you know, I think I would use the resources that Harry has, the technology that he has, and not find a way to do evil with it, but find a way, you know, I think there's a lot of actually technology out in the world that if it was used correctly could solve a lot of the world's problems. And I think a lot of times people take technology and they use it just for personal gain or for convenience or for luxury. But I think if you took a corporation like Oscorp and you said, well, how could we actually use this technology to feed people, to give people things they don't have, maybe to create clean water somewhere. Like, these are technologies that could very easily be made, but instead Oscorp is investing them in really modern-day warfare gadgets and such. So I think I would just redirect the aim of Oscorp altogether.
Andrew and I had talked about this. Andrew had some very specific ideas about his room that came outside of me, which was that his room was chaotic and messy at the beginning of the film because he was so dedicated to Spider-Man that Peter Parker had sort of been left behind. And so there was this feeling of everything was dog-eared and worn around the edges and like not taken care of and dusty. And that was reflective of, I think, Peter Parker's inner life, wouldn't you say? And then we had really wonderful art directors. I mean, I like Antonioni, of course. And he's a photographer. The movie's about a photographer. Peter Parker is a photographer, of course, as we know from the comics. So there was a resonant frequency in that. And then, you know, it's about finding something about, like, it's very easy in comic books to create a world that is a degree away from the reality that we all encounter. So I wanted to put at least one foot in the real world and finding bands and environments like Times Square that are realistic to base the mythology out of, I think helps create that sort of exaggerated, fun, wider spirit that we're trying to promote.
There's one really cool element that I don't know how easy it is to see in the movie, but there are Polaroids all around the room taken from Spider-Man's perspective, and they're all these very like high angle shots of New York City streets, or like perspectives that only Spider-Man could access throughout the city. And I thought that was a really cool little detail. And they're very lonely pictures as well. It kind of communicates that he is a one-man army swinging through a very, you know, the busiest and loneliest city in the world. So it was kind of a nice little thing to isolate him and also give him that privileged position and perspective. It was kind of a cool thing that Mark. You. And, just for the sickness of that question. Spider-Man, Gandhi, gosh, Michael J. Fox, Mark Rylance, Daniel Day-Lewis, Meryl Streep, gosh, Stan Lee, of course.
Gene Wilder?
Gene Wilder, yeah, how do you know that? I like Gene Wilder, yeah, Gene Wilder's great. You know, gosh, it's countless. Joseph Campbell, Michael Meade, Robert Bly, David White, we'll talk later because there's lots of much more exciting people to talk about.
What about you?
Jamie Foxx.
I mean, Muhammad Ali, Prince.
I want to hear that translated.
Martin Luther King, Halle Berry, and how she just, you know, no, in the real sense, and just how, you know, how remarkable she. That's good. Andrew Garfield, Emma Stone, Jack Don, Mark Webb.
Well, the two people that have always really inspired me that are Philip Seymour Hoffman. Ever since I saw him jump out of that red convertible and The Talented Mr. Ripley. And James Dean, honestly, who I just got to play in the film. So, I mean, I have a long list too. You know, Jamie Foxx and but those are two big ones that have, you know, definitely are relevant right now.
Had a huge impact. I mean, that was I love making a movie every night, but in terms of, like, just liberating fun, making the score for the movie was as much fun as I've had ever. We were in a room with Hans Zimmer, Pharrell, Mike Einzinger from Incubus, Junkie XL, Johnny Marr, who was the guitarist of The Smiths. Of course, if you've seen my first movie, you know how big of a fan I am of them. But they all came in with the really wonderful, big spirit of collaboration. And I could go on for hours and hours about the music and the film and the score. But there was Pharrell. When we were doing the Electra music, Pharrell had really locked into Electra's character and wanted to find something deeper in it. And Jamie had found this really great, walked this really great line between having some pathos and having some and psychosis from the beginning of it. And Pharrell really locked into it. And everybody was having so many ideas in the first like 5 or 6 days of the process, and then Pharrell just like got all worked up, and he's like, I gotta go, and he walked out of the studio, and they're like, what's up? I mean, is he okay? He came back about 20 minutes later with all these lyrics written out. It was like the notebooks at 7. It was like super small writing, and he had written basically an aria for Electro's, for Max Dillon, the internal life of Max Dillon, and he had written all these lyrics, and it's something that was so telling and so magnificent that I eventually, at the beginning of the Times Square sequence, would, you know, build out recut the movie at the beginning of the Times Square sequence to accommodate just what he was, just the power of the music there, and it was a really wonderful thing, and at some other point, I'll go into more detail about all the layers of music, particularly in Times Square. But it was a kind of a great collaboration. The other thing, I'll say one more thing, is we put together a record, an album. All these guys, they're very familiar with the pop music form, so they would write songs. And so all these guys wrote about 5 or 6 songs, and then Hans Zimmer would arrange the chord progressions to create the themes, like the love theme. Dun, 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 dun. Jamie could sing it better than I could, but But that came, those, they all came from pop songs, and then they were orchestrated into a, I think a more, a bigger scope, into something that felt more like a score. And that was, it was a new kind of process that I don't think had been done before.
I think what Gwen, the way Gwen has affected me is probably the way that she's affected so many people that read the comic books and were so shocked by what happens with her storyline, which is the theme of the movie, as Mark was saying before, is time. And I think she brought the storyline that was chosen for Gwen when the comics were written, reminded readers, I think there was, expect, I mean, just from what I've read about what happened around this issue 121 coming out, people were so livid and so devastated that they would do this to a character. It was so shocking that I think it probably brought mortality into everybody's minds, that even in a super universe, even with heroes, even with people that save the day, you can't necessarily save everything. And I think she's left me with that, which is something that I've always had, but that need to seize the day, that awareness that no matter how long your life is, it's always too short. And to make the most of each day and to live in the way that you want to live and be the kind of person that you know you are destined to be. I think that's what she's left me with and what she left a lot of readers with, and hopefully will continue to mark people with.
Grazie. Grazie a tutti.